Hello guys, my name is Alex. So if you don't know me, I'm a Han Chinese born and raised in Xinjiang, China. And I share my opinions on certain controversial topics regarding Xinjiang and China here on YouTube. So today I would like to share with you five things about Xinjiang that most foreigners or even Chinese citizens who live outside of Xinjiang don't know. Number one, there is another province, or more accurately, a province-level entity within Xinjiang called Xinjiang Production and Construction Corps, XPCC for short. The XPCC is a unique state-owned economic and semi-military organization in Xinjiang. It has administrative authority over certain medium-sized cities, settlements, and farms in Xinjiang. The green parts on this map are regions administrated by XPCC. They take up more than 4% of Xinjiang's land, which is more than 70,000 square kilometers. It has its own administrative structure, fulfilling government functions such as healthcare, policing, judiciary, and education for areas under its jurisdiction. Yeah, I'm reading Wikipedia right now, but in short, the XPCC is like a state within a state. I have been to many cities administrated by XPCC. One of them was Kuitun City. So when I was walking on the streets of Kuitun, to be honest with you, I was quite confused at the time. There was a question in my mind that, am I still in Xinjiang right now? Because you won't bump into as many Uyghur street vendors selling naan or fruit as you can in other typical Xinjiang cities. Most of the residents there were Han Chinese, and a lot of them tend to speak dialects from other provinces of China, such as Henan and Sichuan, Gansu province. In general, you're gonna feel a vibe that the city is so different with other typical Xinjiang cities in terms of culture, the people, and the way they manage the city. So talking about the history of XPCC, it's originated from an ancient idea. In ancient China, the emperor found that deploying soldiers in frontier areas were too costly. So they ordered the army to grow crops at where they were deployed. This is called military farmers. At late 1949, the newly founded People's Republic of China was also facing the same problem. Transporting supplies from other provinces to Xinjiang was too expensive, and Xinjang at that time was underdeveloped. So the majority of PLA deployed in Xinjiang were ordered to put the military mission aside and focus on construction and production. They began to grow crops, build factories, and continuously improve the lives of the local people. So today, the XPCC's role as a military organization has been weakened in my eyes. Most of its workers are just ordinary people like you and me. Apart from what we mentioned about its role as a government, it also played an important role in Xinjiang's economic development. For instance, in 2020, the XPCC produced 30% of all cottons in China. So talking about the cotton industry of the XPCC, the US banned cotton and cotton products from the XPCC in December 2020 due to the concerns of Uyghur Forced Labor. However, as I mentioned previously, almost 90% of its workers are Han Chinese, but the US sanctioned the XPCC because of concerns of Uyghur Forced Labor. This is quite hilarious in my eyes, but people who don't know much about Xinjiang will tend to miss the real intention behind US sanctions. Anyway, I made another video about Uyghur Forced Labor. I will put the link in the description and you can check it out later. Number 2, not all Uyghurs are Muslims, and for those who are Muslims, they tend to be more secular in comparison with people from other conservative Islamic regions. Some Western medias, they intentionally portrayed Uyghur people as typical Muslims who are very religious and women wear hijabs all the time. By doing this, they have successfully planted a message in your mind, especially in the minds of Muslims all over the world, that China is persecuting their Muslim brothers and sisters in Xinjiang. However, as I said earlier, not all Uyghur people are Muslims, and a lot of them are atheists. They don't practice Islam, but they eat halal food, and they celebrate Islamic festivals such as Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. So those Islamic traditions have become part of Uyghur culture already. As for those Uyghurs who are Muslims, as I said, they tend to be more secular. If you Google Uyghur traditional dress, you will find out that they are so different with other conservative Islamic regions. I have never seen any Uyghur woman in a hijab on the street of Urumqi. They prefer to cover their hair with this kind of scarf or those colorful hats. They love colorful clothes such as atlas silk, a traditional Uyghur clothing material. Moreover, if you have ever been to Xinjiang, you would know that Uyghur people love to dance. Women and men dance together, and they love merry dance music. Those are all unique parts of Uyghur culture that you wouldn't be able to see in other Islamic regions. Unfortunately, people who don't know Xinjiang very well, they tend to ignore those things but just see Uyghur people as stereotyped Muslims. Number 3. The ancient Uyghur people were largely Buddhist or followed Turkic folk religions such as shamanism. During the period spanning the Tang and Song dynasties, Buddhism was the predominant religion practiced by nobility and common people in the Uyghur Kingdom of Gochang and Kingdom of Khotan. Nevertheless, everything changed after the Arab victory in the Battle of Talas in southern Central Asia. After this, in the late 9th century and 10th century, another Turkic tribe, Karakhanid adopted Islam and invaded the Uyghur. They defeated and Islamized the Uyghur, so the Uyghur conversion to Islam was not a voluntary choice made by the common people, but a result of religious war and imposition by the ruling class. In today's Xinjiang, you can still find legacy of Buddhism, such as gazelle caves of southern Buddhas in Baichun, Subashi Temple in Kucha, Ravak Stupa in Khotan, and Basque Lake Southern Buddha Caves in Turpan. Number 4. Intermarriage between Han and Uyghur is strongly opposed by the Uyghur. You may have read news like this. China video ad calls for 100 Uyghur women to urgently marry Han men. China is reportedly sending men to sleep in the same bed as Uyghur Muslim women while their husband are in prison camp. Well, as a Han Chinese who was born and raised in Xinjiang, this is insane in my eyes. Why? Because if that was true, it will trigger the anger of the whole Uyghur community, and it will strongly impact the social stability, which is something the Xinjiang authority don't want to say. Growing up in Xinjiang, I know how difficult it is for intermarriage between Han and Uyghur, especially for a relationship between a Han boy and a Uyghur girl. Any Uyghur girl who is with a Han Chinese boy would be looked down upon by her fellow people. She would even be kicked off from the Uyghur community. any Uyghur Han couple who appear in public risk the verbal and sometimes physical censure from the Uyghur community. I once heard a tragic story of a Han and Uyghur couple. They were married and had a kid, but the Uyghur mother couldn't stand the constant pressure from her family and the Uyghur community, so she finally decided to abandon her husband and son. She left them behind and never went back. Her son was raised by the Han husband alone, and he couldn't remember what does his mother looks like. Well, I'm not saying intermarriage between Han and Uyghur is impossible. I did interview a Uyghur girl whose mother is Uyghur and her father Han Chinese in another video of mine. But such case is very rare in Xinjiang, you know. If you have ever been to Xinjiang, you would know what I'm talking about here. Number 5. Xinjiang is not only home to Han Chinese and Uyghur, but also to other ethnic groups. I've talked about it in another video of mine. You don't know how diverse China is. But I would like to give you more clues about Xinjiang's ethnic composition and distribution in this video. In Xinjiang, overall, the Uyghur account for 47% of the population and the Han 38%. All minority groups, including Uyghur, Kazakh, Hui, Mongol, etc., account for 62%. However, if you look Xinjiang from place to place, the situation varies. For example, in South Xinjiang, places like Kashgar and Hotan, the Uyghur often make up more than 90% of the population. In Urumqi, capital of Xinjiang, the percentage is less than 13%. In Altai, it dropped down to less than 3%. This map illustrates the ethnic distribution of Xinjiang very well. The Han population is along the east-west corridor from Hami to Urumqi and on through Karamai, with branches in Kuala and Aksu. The Hui population follows a similar pattern. The Uyghur population is concentrated in the southern Tarim, in Turpan and Kucha, and in Yining. The Kazakh population is focused in the Altai and the Ili Valley. The Kyrgyz population follows the southern Tianshan. The Mongol population is concentrated around the central Tianshan. Taken together, the distribution of ethnic groups in the 1990s affirms the traditional concentration of Uyghurs in the south, Kazakh in the north, but adds the Han in the central areas, following along the lines of transportation. So as you can see, the ethnic composition and distribution of Xinjiang is rather complicated. You can't just simplify it as a land of Uyghur. If you have ever traveled to Xinjiang from southern Tarim to Altai Mountains in the north, from Turpan in the east to Ili Valley in the west, you would know what I'm talking about here. It's a very diverse place in terms of ethnic, culture, language, and also landscape. However, some Western medias, they seem to care about the Uyghur only. They have been trying by all means to portray the Uyghur as the victim and the Han as the occupier. How about the other ethnic groups? Do they have problems with the government in Xinjiang? Why always the Uyghur? Alright guys, as you can see, the situation in Xinjiang is not someone who just read some news and watch a few videos on YouTube can comprehend. Even I am still learning its history and talking to people with different backgrounds in order to figure out what makes Xinjiang a global controversial topic today. However, there are people who jump rashly to the conclusion that the CCP is oppressing Uyghur in Xinjiang just because they are Muslim minorities. They make you believe them by exaggerating, fabricating, and telling you a simple story with simple logic that most Westerners would buy. The Communist China is evil all the time. They abuse human rights all the time, from Tiananmen Square to Tibet, from Falun Gong to Hong Kong. And now, they are reaching out to Xinjiang. Would you buy their story again?